Okay. Well, good. Do you want me to jump right into it? I'll show my family again. For those of you that weren't here last night, my name is Todd Funk. I'm the National Director of Speaker Development for Thinking Matters. Been in New Zealand for about 17 years now, doing various things along the way, university campus evangelism and pastoring, part of the pastoral staff of a church and leadership institutes. And most recently doing a lot of work with kids, but then also a lot of work with apologetics with Thinking Matters. This is my family, my wife and my biological daughters on the right and their husbands and whatnot on the right side. And then kind of our adopted in daughter on the left with her a family on the left side there. So tonight, I'm going to be talking about the reliability of the New Testament. Nine reasons, notice the ease, to trust the New Testament. Like Jeff said at the beginning, up at the top right part of your screen, they'll say view. So you can kind of, you can put me on half or me in a corner or reduce me altogether, but you can change your views around a little bit. So we'll jump right into it. Now, unless you wanted to say anything else, Jeff, before I got onto it.
No, go ahead, Todd.
You're good. All right. Well, some of you have probably been asked, how do you know the New Testament is true? How do you know, or worse, you might have been accused of the New Testament being accused of being fables or fairy tales or unreliable or been changed over time. And when I was a young Christian trying to defend my faith, someone would say something like this, and well, how do you know the Bible's the Word of God? And I would say, well, because it says it's the Word of God. Well, but how do you know it is? Well, because it says it is. And I would reason kind of circularly, and that's no good in the occasion. So my goal today is to give you answers to these accusations and to bolster and firm up the foundation of your faith in the reliability and trustworthiness and accuracy of the New Testament. So today we're going to basically put the New Testament on trial. And trust me, in our culture, it's on trial all the time. I'm going to present nine lines of evidence that kind of give a veracity or prove out that the New Testament is true, reliable, and accurate. And all of them will start with the letter E to help aid in memory. So we'll jump right into it. The first E of reliability is eyewitness testimony. Eyewitness testimony is the strongest testimony we can have in a court of law. If two or three people say that you did it, that they saw you doing something or not, then we can go to the bank with that. We will find a conviction in the court of law with eyewitness testimony. The church was founded on eyewitness accounts of what Jesus said, of what Jesus did, and including his resurrection. The authors, the writers of the New Testament make no bones about it, that they were writing firsthand eyewitness reports, accounts. Look, for instance, at the way John opens his book. We want to tell you about the Word that gives life, the one who existed before the world began. This is the one we have heard and have seen with our own eyes. We saw what he did and our own hands touched him. Peter opens similarly. He says, we're not telling clever stories that someone has made up. With our own eyes, we saw his true greatness. Luke speaks of his sources being those who from the beginning were eyewitnesses in Luke chapter 1, verse 2. And it's not just that they were eyewitnesses. They also point out that their listening and reading audiences were eyewitnesses as well. It would be as if I said, back in June, I was stargazing and looking at my binoculars and I saw E.T., the extraterrestrial, going across the sky. You all saw it. You know what I'm talking about, and went on. Well, you'd probably chat amongst yourself saying, what is he on about? I didn't see E.T. Did you see E.T.? No, Jeff, don't have him on here again. Whereas if I said, well, back in June, I was looking up in the sky and I saw a blood red supermoon, that eclipse that we saw. Many of you saw it and many of you would have. You would talk about it afterward. Did you see a blood red moon? Oh yeah, it was a super blood red moon. We won't have another one for another 40 or so years. And so in the same way, these authors pointed to their audience. They actually appealed to the knowledge of their readers about the things they spoke about. Peter, at the day of Pentecost, had a huge crowd of several thousand, right? And he said this, he said, you saw all these things, but you know that it's true. there were knowledgeable, hostile witnesses, Jewish witnesses present who would have taken the opportunity to refute anything, any lies that the disciples would have been telling. For instance, they didn't deny that Jesus worked miracles. They rather just claimed that he performed miracles by the power of the devil, Beelzebub. They didn't deny Jesus's body was missing from the grave after he was crucified. They just said that the disciples stole the body. So the disciples proclaimed these truths about Jesus in public, in the synagogues. The bitter enemies of this new upstart religion would have taken every opportunity to refute their testimony and oppose them and expose their errors had there been some. Let me go back on that. It's not there. excuse me. So the disciples confidently appealed to hostile witnesses. In Acts chapter 26, Paul appeared before King Agrippa, and he's saying, King Agrippa, you're familiar with these things. I can speak freely to him. I'm convinced that none of this has escaped his notice because it was not done in a corner. That's when Paul was appealing to Agrippus. In Acts alone, we get 80 eyewitnesses, and in John another 59 eyewitnesses. So in just two books, there's 140 eyewitnesses appeal to. So the New Testament, it's not just that the eyewitness testimony of one person, but of several people, with dozens of references being made to others who witnessed the life, miracles, and even resurrection of Christ. So eyewitnesses in courts of law, they're vetted, they're screened, they're assessed by their ability tell the truth. Man, is that me doing all that? Excuse me. We just jumped all over the place. There we go. So vetted by their, I'll leave this alone for a second here. Eyewitness testimony, they're vetted by their ability to tell the truth. Were they in the right place? Were you there when that murder took place? No, I was around the corner. Well, then you can't be an eyewitness. Were they there at the right time? Well, I was there, but a day earlier, a day late. Again, the disciples were at the right place in Jerusalem. They were at the right time. They were there, not centuries later, and we'll get to that. And then lastly, they had to be vetted by the right motives, which brings me to the second E. So our first E is eyewitness accounts. Our second E is this, that their testimony was ethical, right? When a witness is testifying in a court of law, the opposing counsel is going to try and defame or disqualify or discredit the witness, right? Try and tear the witness down. But we find no such possibility in doing so with the New Testament authors. They're pretty much beyond reproach. They had high ethical standards. The writers of the New Testament did. Matthew and Luke both record Jesus' Sermon on the Mount. Paul lists deceivers as those who were not going to inherit the kingdom of God. Luke begins explicitly stating that he's carefully investigated everything of the accounts of eyewitnesses. He says this. I think I need to approve somebody wanting in, and then I can move on with this. Okay. Here we go. Luke says this. Many have undertaken to draw up an account of the things that have been fulfilled among us, just as they were handed down to us by those who from the first were eyewitnesses and servants of the word. With this in mind, since I myself have carefully investigated everything from the beginning, I too decided to write an orderly account for you, most excellent Theophilus, so that you may know with the certainty of the things you have been taught. So Luke addressed both Acts, which he wrote, and Luke, the gospel that bears his name, to this most excellent Theophilus. And biblical experts believe he was some kind of a political person of importance, some kind of a dignitary, if you will, because Paul uses the same most excellent when he talks about Governor Felix and Governor Festus. And so why would he write something to something that was untrue to a Roman official? Right. At the very least, he'd be found out to be a liar, but worse, he might find himself in prison. So if you're writing an historical account for some political dignitary, you make sure you get the facts right. And can anybody really believe that some of the world's greatest ethical teachings have come from unethical people? There's three motives that usually cause people to either lie or perjure in court of law or even commit crimes in the first place: lust, power, and greed. But there's no evidence that the authors of the New Testament operated under any, they had any of these motives. We've got to look at what were the motives of the New Testament authors. They were not motivated by lust. It's not as if preaching the gospel is a good way to pick up chicks, right? You're not going to pick up lines don't come out of the New Testament. They weren't after girls. They weren't after wealth. Paul said that he worked hard so as not to be a burden on any. He said he coveted no man's money. And in fame and glory, well, they only became famous posthumously. In other words, after they had died. We'll get back to that. Listen to how Paul described his fellow apostles. Seems to me that God has put us apostles in the worst possible place. We're like prisoners on their way to death. Angels and the people of this world just laugh at us. Because of Christ, we are thought of as fools. We are weak and hated. Even today, we go hungry and thirsty and do not have anything to wear except rags. We are mistreated and don't have any place to live. Until now, we are thought of as nothing more than the trash and garbage of this world. 1 Corinthians 4, 9 through 13. So the New Testament authors, they weren't after fame and glory. Paul describes what the apostles went through with that. The New Testament authors would have had more motive to not give an honest testimony. They had everything to lose and nothing to gain for giving their honest testimony. So their motives were to please God, please and glorify and honor God. They wanted to show and demonstrate the fruit of the Spirit and emulate their master, Jesus, and gain heaven. It doesn't make any sense that the New Testament authors would make up any character, anything like Jesus. Jesus was the very anti-hero, the antithesis of the man of a man-made hero. The heroes of the Greeks and the Romans were powerful military leaders. You know, look at Greek mythology, the Thors and whatnot. But Jesus, what do we have? A vulnerable baby born in a manger amongst animals, a weak dying Messiah called the sacrificial Lamb of God. What kind of a school mascot are the lambs? That's not very ferocious, right? Jesus allowed his enemies to mock him and malign him and even murder him. Again, the antithesis, some unknown hero to the ancient world back then. So the character of the New Testament authors is pretty much beyond reproach, and I would have to take the stand against them to try and cross-examine them or depose them, because you couldn't do it. So our first E, they were eyewitness testimonies, and their testimony was ethical, ethically motivated. Our third E, that they were, it's an early witness. There's lots of accusations out there that have been made that the New Testament authors, it's not accurate. It was written several centuries, if you will. Here we go. Several centuries after the event. And it's one thing to make an accusation, but quite another to fill that through. The reality is most of the new documents were written before AD 70, right? With oral testimony coming much earlier than the written. How can we be sure? Well, it's really what's not recorded, what's absent, that gives us the evidence. Let me give you an analogy. Let's say you picked up a book and it was supposedly the history of Christchurch, New Zealand. And you began to read that all the way to the end and there was no mention of the great devastating earthquake of 2011. What a monumental hallmark event left out of it. You'd only assume that this book must have been written before 2011, right? If you read a book about New York City's history and nothing was in it about the 9/11 terrorist attack, you'd assume it was written before 2001, because you just wouldn't leave something so monumental out. So there's several big events that are conspicuously absent if the book was written any later than AD 70. Luke shows a particular interest in the city of Jerusalem. He mentions it 90 times, much more than any other New Testament author. And while Luke does mention several events, big things that happened in Jerusalem, such as the day of Pentecost, the festival there, and the Jerusalem Council and the imprisonment of Paul, these occurred in the 30s, 40s, and 50s. He fails to mention the most important events of the city, which happened later on. For instance, the severe persecution of Christians under the Emperor Nero, which began in about the mid-60s. The wars that were waged against Jerusalem beginning in 66, the siege of Jerusalem in 69, and lastly, the destruction of the temple in Jerusalem. This was a biggie. Jesus predicted that not one stone would be left upon another, and none were when Titus came in and flattened it and leveled it. Also conspicuously absent are the martyrdom of Peter in 65, Paul 64, James in AD 61. And so we contrast this with what is recorded in the Bible, the John the Baptist, his martyrdom in AD 27, and the martyrdom of Stephen in AD 36. But again, when Peter and Paul and James were martyred in the 60s, nothing is mentioned about them, leaving us to believe that these books were written before those times. Now, even if they were written, say, 15 years after, I mean, there's good evidence that Matthew might have been written as early as the 40s, and Mark maybe in the 50s, and Luke in the 50s as well. But you might think, well, that's still 15 years after the events occurred. How do we know they got them right? Well, several things. First of all, these were given to a very oral culture. The Hebrews were an oral culture. They prized themselves in being able to memorize. Craig Bloomberg, an author, he points out that about 80 to 90% of Jesus's words were written in poetic form. Not that they rhyme, but they had meter and balanced and parallelisms, which helps in memorization. The disciples of anyone back then were expected to memorize the words and sayings of their master, of their teacher. The disciples of Jesus would be no different. And thirdly, Jesus promised that the Holy Spirit would bring words to their remembrance. The Holy Spirit would help them to remember what they were. If you still think that 15 years seems like a lot of time between the events and when they were first recorded, well, let's compare that to some histories of people that are not debatable. For instance, I'm going to skip this because I don't have time. Muhammad, the earliest records of Muhammad we don't get until about 760 AD. That's 125 years after he died, then edited for another 50 years. The first records of Buddha come 350 years after Buddha's death. The first records of Tiberius Caesar, he was the one in rule at the time of Christ, come 77 years later by Tacitus. The two earliest biographies of Alexander the great Greek conqueror that nobody doubts, came 400 years after his death through, you know, Arian and Plutarch. So we've got our first eyewitness testimony coming from very ethical authors written very early in the piece, especially historically speaking, compared to other well-known, well-attested people. So their testimonies were also, let me go back. This is wrong. I don't know if I'm bothering this thing or somebody else. I'll leave this alone. Extended testimony. What do I mean by this? Well, the disciples were with Jesus for 24/7 for about 3.5 years. Specifically regarding the resurrection, Jesus appeared to people for 40 days after his resurrection. It wasn't 40 minutes or 40 seconds or 40 hours. It was 40 days. So it was an extended amount of time, enough to get a good grip and look and eyewitness of what was going on. Some people say, well, the disciples hallucinated things. Well, not for 40 days, they wouldn't. Not if for 3.5 years and seeing the miracles and what he did. It doesn't make sense. There's no group hallucinations recorded anywhere. Anyway, think about John F. Kennedy. His life is not under the debate that his policies and politics and what he did, and that he was a womanizer. He was one of the presidents of the United States, for those of you that don't know. But what is under debate is the events surrounding his death, his assassination in the 1960s. Was it one shooter or was it two? was the CIA involved? Was it a political cover-up? What was the angle of the bullet? Why? Because all that happened in a moment, right? His lifetime and his career happened in an extended time, and there's no debate about it. But what happened in the brief moments of his assassination are under debate. So the testimony about Jesus by the New Testament authors was an extended testimony, taking time. Our fifth E, embarrassing testimony. It would be very, very easy to be skeptical about the truthfulness of the New Testament authors had they made themselves out to be rock stars, superheroes. But they were superheroes without any pants, as you see there. The rule of thumb for researching historical documents, if there's something that's kind of self-embarrassing to the author, it's probably true, because you don't make up embarrassing things about yourself. For instance, if you were to find a diary of mine and you started reading through it, how when I was a young married man with young kids and read how that I had lost my four-year-old child at the park because I got overly involved in a pickup basketball game, you'd probably believe it was true. Why would I make such a story up to make myself up such, to be such a failure as a dad, right? By the way, that's sadly is exactly what happened. Of course, I told my wife about it. Years and years later, that is. So the New Testament authors, they depict themselves as dim-witted several times, kind of missing the point of what Jesus was talking about. We see this in Mark chapter 9, verse 31. He said, the Son of Man is going to be delivered into the hands of men and they will kill him. But they didn't understand. They were asking what he was on about. Try and move this clicker. You see me not touching it, but it's clicking ahead of me there. In Matthew chapter 15, verse 50, they said, explain the parable of us. And Jesus said, are you still so dull of understanding? In Mark chapter 16, verse 6 through 9, be careful, be on your guard against the leaven of the Pharisees. And they said, is it because we didn't bring any bread? So they really depict themselves to be dim-witted. They were also uncaring. Three times, or twice rather, they fell asleep on Jesus in his moment of need, in his hour of need in the Garden of Gethsemane. They made no effort to give Jesus a proper burial. It was Joseph of Arimathea, a member of the Sanhedrin, the very Jewish party that were responsible for his crucifixion, that gave him a proper burial. How embarrassing is that? And of course, the disciples forbade the children, you know, get those children away. Jesus is much too busy. And Jesus says, no. He says, allow the kids to come, for such belong the kingdom of heaven. They're rebuked. Peter is called Satan by Jesus. He said, get thee behind me, Satan. And you remember Paul rebukes Peter for his hypocrisy and not wanting to eat with the Gentiles. The cowards. Peter denies Jesus three times that he knew him. The disciples at the arrest in the garden before the crucifixion there, all the male disciples bailed and ran away. Only the women were left. The men were locked behind closed doors in locked rooms. And lastly, it was the women that had discovered the empty tomb. The men were cowering away in a locked room. There were also doubters, same disciples, when the women came back and reported the story. They doubted it. They had to run back to the grave themselves. Thomas says, I'm not going to believe unless I put my fingers in the nail holes in his hands. They, despite being told several times that Jesus was going to rise from the dead, they doubted the whole thing. Some even doubted after they had seen the risen Jesus at the Mount of Transfiguration. We find that in Matthew chapter 28. So these are eyewitness testimony coming from ethical writers, coming very early in the piece for an extended time, 40 days after, you know, post-resurrection. And very embarrassing, self-embarrassing points that you wouldn't want to make up. The next is excruciating. The testimony was excruciating. If you've ever seen any of these shows where terrorists are being tortured to try and give up the location of the bomb or the sleeper cell or whatever, they usually give it up if they're tortured enough. Now, a defense lawyer would ask a jury this question. What did the New Testament writers have to gain by making up new religion, right? What would they have to gain? They were excommunicated from the synagogues as heretics and blasphemers. Remember Stephen, he was stoned to death. They were beaten and tortured and killed, some thrown to the lion's den. Some of the disciples died as martyrs' deaths, right? They died as martyrs' deaths. James was martyred for his faith in the late AD 60s, according to Josephus, the Jewish historian. Peter was crucified. Paul was beheaded at Rome, more than likely. John didn't die, but he lived his life in exile on the Isle of Patmos. Can you imagine being exiled? You're in your 90s, you're old, and you're being exiled on the island of Patmos to work in the mines as an old man for being a traitor to the Roman Empire. All you have to do is renounce this Christianity foolishness. But he doesn't. He stays there working in the mine, willing to work, willing to die there. Why would he do that if there weren't a truth in what he was recording, if he hadn't seen the resurrected Jesus? My biggest question is why they would have had more motive to deny it than affirm it, but why would they die for a known lie? This is a question I've never had a good answer to. Why would these, some of the apostles, the disciples, why would they die for something they knew was a lie? Let that sink in. Many people die for something they believe strongly in. We see terrorists and suicide bombers doing that. They believe Allah is the one true God. They will be awaited by 70 virgins in heaven and paradise, right? They believe that. But this would be very, very, very different. They would have known, of all people, especially James, the half-brother of Jesus, would have known whether Jesus really did rise from the dead, whether they saw this resurrected God-man. Why do you spend the rest of your life telling a lie if it's a lie? Thomas went to southern India and preached the gospel until he was martyred or whatever happened to him. Why would he leave his family, his culture, his nation, everything familiar to go someplace and spend the rest of his life perpetrating a lie if it were a lie? People just don't do that. So our testimony is eyewitness. It's ethical. It's early. It's extended. It's embarrassing. And it's excruciating. It's also exact testimony. How many of you like the things to be exact? I do. I'm a melancholy personality. I want to know exactly how many miles, exactly how long it's going to take, exactly how much ingredient we need if I'm making something. My wife is more of a bit of a sanguine, you know. I mean, we went millions of miles. We traveled for hours and hours and just flowery stories and whatnot. But I'm the sanguine and the exact one. The writers of the New Testament, especially Luke, they record with amazing accuracy. The New Testament lists 140 specific details, the names of places, political terms and political figures, local environmental conditions, meteorological conditions like wind directions and speeds, trivial details, water depths, the names of peculiar towns, which had later been changed in the second and third century, customs and geographic and topographic conditions, circumstances which only befit eyewitnesses right there in the first century. There are at least 30 people, characters named in the New Testament who have been confirmed historically and archaeologically by non-Christian sources. The classical scholar Colin Hemer, he wrote a book, The Book of Acts, in the setting of Hellenistic history. He goes through the book of Acts, Luke's writing. He goes through it verse by verse, line by line, and he details 84 facts that are confirmed by history and archaeology. Luke names 11 historically recognized leaders, including Herod the Great, Caesar Augustus, Quirinius, not easy for me to say. He names 32 countries, 54 cities, and 9 islands flawlessly without error. He gives the exact titles of details of things that only could be known by a firsthand eyewitness of the first century. He identifies army units and trade routes. He gets it right. Craig Bloomberg, another scholar, writes another book about John's gospel, confirming 59 facts that are verified by history and archaeology. In the late 20th century, there was a Scottish archaeologist named William Ramsay, who worked in the ancient Near East, modern-day Turkey, uncovering, doing his archaeology. Now, because of his liberal university training, he set out with a lot of bias, right? The New Testament, and especially Luke, is not historically trustworthy. That was his opening starting premise because of the university that he went to, very liberal and very anti-New Testament. By the end of Ramsay's long, distinguished career, several things had occurred. Firstly, he was honored with 9 honorary doctorate degrees from prestigious universities around the world. He became an honorary member of almost every association devoted to archaeology and historical research. He contributed so much to the history of the ancient Near East, writing over 20 books, that he was knighted by King Edward VII. And most important to our discussion, the more he unearthed, the more his archaeology, the more he discovered there, the more he came to trust the New Testament, to the extent that by the end of his long career, he called himself a Christian and made a couple of pretty bold claims. He said, Luke's history is unsurpassed in respect of its trustworthiness. And he said, Luke as a historian of the first rank should be placed with the very greatest of historians. Again, how would he have known so much How would these writers have known so much about the precise, exact details if they were written a century or two later? It's not very likely that that's going to happen at all. And why would they get meticulous details down to the minutia, get those right, only to miss it hugely on the big narrative, what Jesus did, said, taught, his miracles, and especially his resurrection? It's been quipped that every time somebody puts a spade in the shovel, a shovel in the ground in the ancient Near East, another page of the Bible is proven out. 1961, the Pilate inscription, confirmed that Pilate was in the town of Caesarea, that Pilate was the governor. In the 1990s, the tomb of Caiaphas, the high priest that was presiding over the time of when Jesus was on trial. The Church of the Holy Sepulchre sits, a lot of scholars believe, right over the tomb where Jesus was laid. So we've got eyewitness testimony given by ethical men early on for an extended amount of time. They wrote embarrassing things about himself. They were under excruciating duress. Had they been lying, they would have given it up. And they recorded exactly. Our next is extra-biblical testimony. It's claimed that more should be written about Jesus, such an important man, if he was such a big deal. Well, Jesus lived over 2,000 years ago. He's an ancient figure of history, and there's some things that we need to remember about historical figures from this point in time. Number one, there are very few manuscripts at all from the first century that survive in Jesus's time. Historians at that time wrote little about religious figures, but a lot about political figures and war. Jesus ministered not in Rome, the center of the Roman Empire, but in a little enclave, in a corner there in Galilee region. And Jesus was active for a relatively short time, 3.5 years. All this considered, there are 10 major non-Christian sources within 150 years of the New Testament. When taken in combination, they confirm what the New Testament says, that Jesus was a miracle worker and that he had 12 apostles and that he was a famed teacher and healer, that he was crucified under Pilate, that he went by the title of the Christ. Now compare this 10 non-Christian sources with that of the ruler of the Roman Empire at the time, Tiberius Caesar. There's only 9 different texts which confirm his existence and what he did. So we have no more non-biblical confirmation of Christ than we do for the ruler of the Roman government at the time. If we include Christian testimony, that number jumps up to well over 30 witnesses. So it's only the most rabid and pretty much uninformed atheist that would say, well, maybe Jesus never really lived. Right? You put those in the same category as your flat earthers and you're not your moon hoax landing type people. So I'll refer to a couple of pagan Jewish and Christian writings outside the New Testament. Hostile non-Christian writings, pagan witnesses are Arthalus, writing in 52, Pliny the Younger, Suetonius, Tacitus, one of the greatest Roman historians, Marabar Serapion in 70 AD, Phlegon, Lucian, Celsus. And then hostile non-biblical but Jewish witnesses would be Josephus, the Jewish Talmud, and the Toledot Yushe. So we've got lots of extra-biblical testimony. We should the Bible testimony should be enough. But if you need some outside, there's 9 that point to them. Our last E of the day is existing documents, technically known as extant documents, existing text documents, and I'll play a video.
Let me ask you about this question, because this is one that has come up in my discussions with other people. Of the earliest extant manuscripts, mm-hmm. there are differences. There are clearly differences yep. in the text. I think a scholar yep. like you would be the first to yep. admit that. Why do those not bother you? That's a place that a lot of skeptics yep. like to go to. If this is God's word, well, why didn't God communicate it clearly? Why did he communicate it with differences in the earliest manuscripts?
Yeah, that's a great question. I get that question a lot. In fact, a number of the different things I've written have been about textual criticism, which has to do with the transmission of these documents. There's lots of things about that people need to know, when I think, in terms of why we can trust these documents. But one of the major things to realize is that the New Testament is no different than any other historical document when it comes to transmission. In other words, any document, if you want to transmit it over time, has to be copied by hand by scribes. So whether you're copying Plato or Aristotle or whether you're copying Galatians, everyone's in the same boat. And so the question then at that point is, if scribes make mistakes, can we work our way back to what the scribe or what the original author actually said? There's lots of ways to do that, but one of the main ways we can do that is if we have a lot of copies of that book. The more copies we have, the better. And so if you have a lot of copies that you can compare to one another, the more assurance you can have that you can go back to the original source. And when it comes to the New Testament, we're in a great position there. We have more copies of New Testament writings than any other document in ancient history, which is an amazing fact and one that we want to continually remind people of.
And the other thing that I've heard scholars such as yourself say to reassure those of us who believe in the Bible as authoritative is, we know where the differences are, and they are not significant when it comes to the general message of the gospel.
That's
Unpack
right.
that a little bit.
Yeah, well, the key is that first phrase, we know where the differences are. The scary thing for us would be that there was a change in the text that we didn't know happened.
Right.
And we think it's original when it really isn't. But this goes back to the number of manuscripts. We have so many, we can compare them, and we can see where the changes are made. And so the key is that we know they happen. And if you can spot them when they happen, then you know they're not original. And once you know they're not original, then their importance fades away. And so even if a scribe here made a big change or a scribe here made a little change, as long as we know they made the change, then we know they're not original, and we can work our way back to the original text. So that's the major issue. There's only two major changes to the text of the New Testament in the first place, and that is the longing of Mark and the story of the adulterous woman in John 8. Outside of that, most of the changes are really small, spelling errors and word order changes and things like this.
So accurate reconstruction of the originals is much easier the greater the number of the copies. Now, by originals, I mean this. We don't have anything from the Old or New Testament that came directly from the author that wrote them. Those are originals. Manuscripts are what were written after. They were copies of what the original wrote, right? So errors are, like he said, errors are easy to spot because we have so many existing manuscripts to determine what the original said. Let me use a familiar example. How many of you have predictive texting or speech to text and you've had it go very bad? You speak something in and send it only to realize, oh my goodness, what was I sending? Let me give an example of four imaginary text messages that were sent out. Every single one of them is wrong. So there's about an 18% margin of error here. But watch how the more text that we send, the more you can hone in on the meeting. First text, and I've highlighted the errors in blue. Meet me at Starbucks, Main Street at 2:30 on Thursday the 16th to correct your money. Gets it wrong. I send it again. Meet Mr. at Starbucks on Main Street at Hernia, whatever that is, on Thursday the 60th to collect your money. Let me go for it again. Meet Starbucks on Mason Street at 2:30 on Thursday the 16th to connect your money. Wrong again. Meet me at Starving on Main Street at 2:30 on Thursday the 16th to collect your money. Now, not one single line has it completely accurate, but how many would feel pretty confident that you could ascertain exactly where we were to meet, when we were to meet, what time we were supposed to meet, the date, and what we were going to do in the meeting? I think we all could. And so it's the same way that we can reconstruct the New Testament because we have so many. Now, there's not nearly as many errors as I've just put here. I used an example going the opposite direction to show you that the more text we have, the more easy it is to decipher exactly what the originals would have said. So before we delve right in, well, how many manuscripts of the New Testament are there? They're written by handwritten. Well, first let's see how many survive from historically accepted figures and the details about their lives. For comparison, we know this about Caesar and the Gallic Wars, and there's only 10 extant, that's existing manuscripts. We know about Tacitus, the number one Roman historian, there's only 20. We know about Plato with 7 manuscripts. We know about Pliny the Younger, and there's only 7. We know about Herodotus, the famous Greek historian. There's only 8 existing manuscripts. We know about Sophocles with 139 and Euripides with 9. We know about Aristotle, the very famous Greek philosopher and scientist, still considered one of the greatest thinkers in politics and psychology around. And there's only 49 manuscripts. In second place to the New Testament is a fiction novel written by Homer called the Iliad. So in first place, we got the New Testament. Any guesses? There we go. we've got the New Testament. Now, we haven't had any more than you know, most of them are below 50 existing manuscripts. But with the New Testament, we have got a staggering 24,633 existing manuscripts, 5,500 Greek, 10,000 Latin, and 8,000 Coptic, and 36,000 quotes of portions of the New Testament. So a stack of all existing classical writings would be about 4 foot high, about to my waist, for all classical, from the classical period. Every writing outside the Bible would be about 4 feet high. Compare that with the writings of the New Testament, which stack up about 2 kilometers high. If you did the whole Bible, it would be, you know, like 2.5 miles high. So accusations of the Bible being changed either accidentally or deliberately by emperors and popes and whoever wanted to is highly unlikely. That it was changed like the old game of telephone or whispers, where you whisper into one person's ear and then they whisper into the next and the next on down the line until the final message is completely distorted. There's no way that could happen because there were so many copies produced so early and distributed so broadly into Asia, Europe, and North Africa. You'd have to change all the copies without being noticed. For an example, if a mother wanted to get their son off to school on time because she just can't get him out on time, she changes the clock in his room, sets it forward by 20 minutes. He wakes up, oh my goodness, I'm running late. Well, to keep the gig up, she would have to also change the clock in the hallway and the clock in the kitchen. And of course, his wristwatch or his telephone and the bus driver and people on there, and on it goes. To get him to school with still thinking he's running 20 minutes late, there would be a multitude of watches all over the place that would need to be changed. And that's the story with the New Testament. So we use, you know, if we use the rules of textual criticism consistently across all ancient documents, we find the Bible is some of the most reliable documents of all ancient history there, with 9 E's of reliability. Now, pause for a minute. If you've been writing notes, don't look at them. See how many of those E's you can remember. I'll give you a moment. You can use your fingers. All right, let's see. Eyewitness, ethical, early, extended, embarrassing, excruciating, exact, extra biblical, and existing. There's 9. Now, beyond this very objective, historical, textual, and archaeological facts, beyond these 9 E's that I've given you, there's one more reason that we can know and trust the New Testament. And I'll let Don Piper explain. Maybe.
Yes, we can trust the 66 books of the Bible. We can stake our lives on these.
Can you hear that?
We lost it, Todd. It was going for about 2 seconds.
Yeah, okay, let me restart it. I don't know what would have happened. Okay, let's go again. Let me stop share, and I'll go again with share, and I will sound. We'll go for this.
Most essentially is by means of the Bible. We can stake our lives on these books. And the way we come to this conviction, most essentially, is by meeting Jesus Christ in the pages of this book. He stands forth from the pages in the story that has been written in a way that is self-authenticating and compelling. You meet him, he befriends you, he reduces you to a humble brokenness, he reveals himself sufficient for you in his cross, He becomes beautiful and glorious in his living and dying and rising, such that you cannot not see the magnificence of the glory and the beauty of Jesus Christ. So there's a spiritual thing that happens here. There's an objective reality that happens there. And when that objective reality and this spiritual transformation meet, light happens, and you know that this is true. Now, there are a lot of other objective historical bases and grounds, but when it comes down to an individual coming to deep conviction by which he can die, it happens at that level of seeing in and through the words and the story to the person of Jesus Christ himself, who then vindicates his word in its entirety.
So the truth is not a bunch of facts to be known, learned, but a person to be known. You meet Jesus and you meet the truth, and the questions kind of tend to fade away when you have life transformation. So hopefully I've deposited a little bit of confidence in you that, yeah, the books that you hold, the 27 books of the New Testament, we can rely on them. It's trustworthy. The accusations against them are by and large baseless accusations. Maybe you're here listening and you've kind of always believed a little bit like Sir William Ramsay, who's quite skeptical and thought that they were unhistorical. Well, hopefully you're one step closer to believing in the trustworthiness of Scripture and believing in the one to whom the Scripture points to, that is Jesus Christ. So 90s of reliability, there they are, a bit of an apologetic for you. So are we doing some question answers and answers now, Jeff?
Yes, let's do some questions and answers. So please type your questions in the chat box.
Okay.
That's incredible. Todd, have you ever had someone come to faith in Christ based off what you just shared?
Probably not that alone, but when there was an honest objection and it came up, I was able to answer it. Rationally and intelligently dispelled the barrier. And I always say, you've got to discern what the barrier is to people. If it's truly a rational, intellectual one, then you can answer with rationale and intellect and that kind of reason. If it's, more of an emotional reason, they've been disappointed by God or whatever, we've got to deal with that separately. If it's a volitional reason where people are just stubborn and you're going to make up their own mind about things, you've just got to drop the truth and leave it to them with prayer, bathing it in prayer. But no, not directly, I haven't.
Great. Okay. I don't see any questions. I'm wondering, Todd, if we can, I feel like the nine E's are begging for the complete 10, a perfect 10.
Yeah.
And I'm wondering if a 10th E could be something about how the New Testament fulfills so many prophecies of the Old Testament.
I can't think of an E. Yeah, it is. It's expected testimony. That's the 10th E, but usually I don't have enough time in that. It's expected testimony. We see Isaiah chapter 53 about the suffering Messiah, and Jesus fulfills that to a T. We see the 22nd Psalm, where Jesus fulfills 16 of the prophecies of the 22nd Psalm. And so it's an expected testimony. Yes, that is yet another E. So if you want a 10th, there it is. Expected. We expected it back in the Old Testament, and we got it in Jesus. Good thinking.
Great. Okay. Yeah, I like that. So expected testimony.
Expected. It was expected, and he fulfilled.
Yeah. That's great. Wow. I hope we can all remember some, if not all, of these E's. We have one question. And yes, the people want the slideshow, it looks like, Todd, and I know that I do. So
that's fine. You're recording this, right? So it'll replay on that. And
would you be willing to share your slides? I don't want to put you on the spot, but you can think about it.
That's fine. They can see those and refer to those. That's fine.
We'll put a link on the YouTube notes, and also you can go to Firm Foundation New Zealand to find that.
Yeah. Would it be helpful if I shared my notes, the notes that I'm obviously going off of here? because I want the word to get out. I want people to be equipped by it. And so I have no problem sharing notes with jokes and all on there. I just don't. If you want me to get them to you in PDF and you can give them to people, yeah, you can do that as well. If you want the PowerPoint presentation, you want to redo this somewhere, then by all means, do it. This is pinched from historians and podcasters and stuff, and I've taken from here and there. And I want to get the word out. So,
Todd, that's exactly it. I mean, that's the whole point of this. We have, 80 or so participants tonight, but what would it look like if we all took this and maybe taught a Sunday school class or a youth group?
Beautiful.
So, this is incredible evidence of our faith. I mean, when you put all 10 together, mm-hmm, I don't know how a rational person really could go away thinking that the New Testament was a joke. I mean, it is solid. It is so well supported. And the content of it, which is Jesus and his work on the cross and in the empty tomb, put all that together. And I mean, we can't lose as Christians. I feel like we can't be beat because our faith is so solid historically.
Yeah, no, amen. I might be biased on that, but I don't see how the naysayers, the atheists, have a leg to stand on when there's a preponderance of evidence out there that point towards authenticity.
Okay.
And Sunday morning, you'll see some, if you're tuning in on Sunday morning, you'll see some of these a little bit overlapping, these arguments for the resurrection of Christ. But there's three big rocks I always try and put in the bucket, especially if I'm dealing with young people. Theism. How do we know? How can we prove there's a God? And there's an acronym I use to prove that out. How do we know the New Testament is accurate, reliable, and true, which you just heard? How do we know Jesus really rose from the dead? Those are three anchors that I like to deposit. So Sunday morning, I'll talk about the resurrection.
That's awesome. Todd, you could post your PDF in the chat box when we stop recording.
Uh-huh.
So you could do that directly here, but also send them to me and I'll put a link to YouTube.
You're referring to my notes, my lecture notes?
Your notes. Yep, your lecture notes. That's right. And there is a way to add it to the chat. But I want to tell everyone, all of this is going to be available free on YouTube. Just go to Firm Foundation New Zealand YouTube channel. Awesome. And you can watch this video, all the videos from this weekend, and spread them to as many people as you can.
Yep.
So we've got a lot of good questions. I think we should stop for tonight. But one good question is, what about the Old Testament? What arguments can we make for the authenticity of the Old Testament?
Yeah, well, I know this guy named Jeff Coleman does a big talk on the Old Testament. And I've heard it. Remember that we did that conference in Christchurch and you got up and did the Old Testament, blah, 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 and then I got up and did this exact talk. So, yeah, that's you, buddy. That's you.
But it looks like we conducted the poll and it looks like not a single person said they didn't like the idea of doing this on Sunday and Monday night. About 2/3 said that they want to continue. So I'm thinking that Todd, you might want to plan on speaking if you can, if your wife allows you, on Sunday evening. And you could maybe do your Darwin delusion part one and part two, which you've prepared for.
Yeah, so I'm going to do what I call the Darwin delusion. I was a biology teacher. Biology, UC Irvine. I got a biology degree and a chemistry minor. And one of the talks I love doing is about Darwinian evolution. I do a talk that's a two-part talk. The first part talks about the historical and sociological ramifications of Darwinism. And then I begin to falsify it. I talk about the scientific and noted problems with that, the atheist theory of atheist godless evolution. It's a two-part talk, but we only thought I was going to do it in one crunch tomorrow night. We'll talk, Jeff, and we'll see if we want to go tomorrow night and Sunday night. Is that what you're thinking?
Yeah, that's right. I'd like to hear both. So, and it looks like the general consensus is to do both. So,
okay. Yeah, no problem. I'm getting what, $500 per talk. So let's say 500 last night, 500 tonight, 500 more.
Yeah, right. No, we'll man. See. We'll see.
They'll be eternal rewards for me. So yeah, absolutely. We'll work that. All right. We'll work that.
Okay. All right. Well, let's let everyone go to bed. Thanks for being here tonight, and we'll see you tomorrow night at 7:00.
Cool, man.